Okay, Dr. George, your life, you can begin whenever you'd like.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, our blessed Holy Trinity, be blessed forever. Amen. When we speak of divine love, we definitely have to speak of grace, charis. My main reference is Saint Athanasius of Alexandria, because he is the main source of orthodoxy in the 4th century. No one before him and no one after him. Even the great Saint Cyril has completed the work of Saint Athanasius, built on the foundation that has been before Saint Athanasius, and continued the work without actually adding anything new, but extending the what has been bequeathed to the Christian tradition of Alexandria. What is grace? Grace is the divine love manifested towards humanity. There has been a discussion in the West. It concerns us because of what happened in the 20th century in Egypt. Is grace created or uncreated? Is it divine or is it an act of a created hell given to humanity by the Son of God? We are in the East always late in making announcement about what we believe to be true and correct. Partly because we are very engaged in our monastic ascetic life and we prefer to stay on the safe side, not to take the risk of rediscovering our own foundation. But that has backfired indeed and led us into a situation where we are now unable to challenge the heretical understanding of the work of the Holy Spirit, of Holy Communion, the Eucharist, and the indwelling of the Holy Trinity in our hearts as Christians. This has been, these subjects or these topics of our Christian faith has been under attack in the last 40 years. First of all, if we follow Saint Athanasius historically, we realize that grace, charis, in its ontological existence is the grace of the image of God. And in chapter 5 of his great work on the Incarnation, he speaks of two kinds of grace. The grace of being created by the divine love of humanity and the grace of the divine image, in order that we may live like God, a divine life. Then of course the question is the divine image in us an image of God, a created image of God, or still a divine image? Well, it is both. It's a gift of uncreated grace bestowed on us to a created human person. Now, as a result of the fall and our corruption, natural corruption, these are the words of Saint Athanasius, our tendency towards being enslaved by the elements of the universe, according to Paul in Colossians chapter 2, we became actually locked into a created system. We deal with creation more than we deal with the uncreatedness. As a result of that, it became very hard for us to recognize what has been divine in us. And when we say that there is a divine element in our being, as human beings, people rebel and get frightened and think that we have trespassed and left orthodoxy. That's not true. But let us say three things about the uncreated or the divine elements of our image, the divine image in us. Number one, it is the revelation of the true knowledge of God. This true knowledge is not ideas. It's an encounter with the divine light. It's an encounter with God Himself, who is uncreated, and He Himself shines His divine light into our life. This knowledge is not something that we receive by deduction or by study, but by the illumination of the Spirit of God, where the divine light shines in us. One of the favorite words from the Old Testament in the Psalms by Saint Athanasius is quoted very often, "By your light we shall see light." Knowledge. And then eternity. Eternal life is not a created life. What has been created is certainly temporary. It cannot be eternal, because God alone is eternal. And we have been created to live eternally, but we failed. But as we failed, Christ came to renew in us that hunger and thirst for eternal life. So we are eternal. And that when we speak of grace, we speak of an eternal grace. The grace of adoption is the same word used for adoption, is the same word is deification. Deification is where we participate in the life of the Son, because now He is the head who brings us into full communion with the Father. So adoption is certainly the eternal grace that was given to us. Number three, it's love. Love has suffered a great deal of abuse by us, by our theologians, by the fact that our mortality, as I have referred several times, did divine love for us. But divine love is immortal. It cannot be subjected to mortality. Divine love is immortal, and we know that divine love because we have been enlightened or illumined by the Spirit of Love, who dwells in us to reveal to us that love, and we participate in that love. Love is the very life of God. And the very life of God is uncreated life. This actually brings us close to the anti-Arian arguments in Discourse 1, 2, and 3 of Saint Athanasius against the Arians. These discourses need really a fresh translation into Arabic. The Arabic translation that was published by the Patristic Center is not bad. It needs revision, like any other translation. Because what we see clearly in these discourses is four important elements. When we talk about grace, we have to speak clearly, without any hesitation, of four things. Number one, and that is very important for us to remember, is that grace is a participation in the life of Christ. He is divine, and our participation in Christ brings the divine life into our life. It's an act of love. It's not an act of favor, as in the evangelical theology. No. We participate in His sonship. And Saint Athanasius, in the second discourse, says that this has been, grace has been preserved and kept in the Son before the creation of the cosmos. in order that when we come to receive this grace, we will have the eternal life. Christ is the foundation. That I love this these paragraphs in the second discourse, starting from paragraph 66 onwards. He's a foundation on which everything is built. Built in order to bring us as temples of the Holy Spirit. Because in the building up, we go back to the foundation that has been in God before the foundation of the world, to go back prior to the whole, the eternal plan of God. And thus, we are drawn into the sonship, grace of sonship, to the Son. Number two, he is very keen to tell us that Christ is the vine of the branches, according to his humanity. But the humanity of Christ has been made divine. It remains human, but has been divinized. It becomes immortal, becomes life-giving. It's integrated in the divine person of the second person. That is no longer under corruption, under pain, under suffering, but shares in the glory of the second person. And we are transformed and become like him. In the second discourse, there are two texts are absolutely important. Let me read them to you. I hope I can read them in Greek, but let me read them to you in English. And then I hope you will read that in the English translation or even in the Arabic translation. The Arabic translation of the Patristic Center is on page 97. He says, he became man for our sakes and became our brother by having a body like our body. And that's why he was called the firstborn. And because all human beings have perished because of the transgression of Adam, please listen to these words carefully. His flesh or his body was the first one that has been saved and liberated because it is the body of the Logos himself. His body has been liberated from death by its union with the divine person, by its ability to defeat death. And then as we have been united to this body, we are saved according to what happened to his body. But in a more shocking statement, this is actually paragraph 2, discourse 2, paragraph 61. And if you move on, I really beg you to read this second discourse. Read it. Because here is another statement. Paragraph 65. Now truth has been revealed and became obvious that the Logos is not a creature but does not belong to the created order. And when we say that he is the beginning of the way, we say because the first way has been lost through Adam. It has deviated and has led to death instead of being in paradise. And we all heard the verdict, you are dust and to dust you shall return. Therefore, here are the shocking statements. The Logos of God, the lover of mankind, put on the body, the created body, according to the will of the Father, in order to give life to this body by his own blood. The body has been put to death by the first man. The Arabic translation is not bad at all, very close to the Greek. كلمه الله المحب للبشر لبس الجسد المخلوق بمشيئه الاب لكي يحيي بدم نفسه هذا الجسد الذي اماته الانسان الاول سبب تعدي. I like that because it is when Christ died on the cross, you know, it is his blood, his life, that was given as a sacrifice that made that body comes back to life. It has been offered in order that it may live. It actually conquered death. That the cross is the conquering of death. The resurrection is the evidence of its immortality. So the cross is a sign of our victory. And so here is the transformation of that into incorruption, into immortality, into the glory of the Son of God, is what gives us salvation, because we shall become like him. As he is the vine, we are the branches, and we shall be transformed and become like his humanity. What a great love, in order to become like him. And that is, here is grace. Grace is a change in the being. It's not a change in the ethical, moral behavior. It's a change of our being that brings a change in our ethical, moral behavior. Number three, this is not just done by the Son. It is actually what we have received from the Son by the Spirit. But all comes back to the Father. The running line in the letter to Serapion, very simple to remember. All things, all blessing, every grace from the Father, in the Son, by or through the Spirit. So divine grace is actually participation in Christ. It's not what we think, what we believe, what we say, what we discourse, but what we receive. You know, to use the simple vocabulary of Jacob of Sarug, he says, there is a difference between someone saying to a woman, I want to marry you, and someone who actually marries her. And he said, the first discourse is what we have as catechumens. When we offer in our education, in our teaching, the grace of God. But the second one is when we receive grace. You can talk to me about Christ as much as you can. There's no harm in that. But the most important thing is, do you receive Christ by the Spirit in your life or not? Because the receiving of Christ by the Spirit is certainly our union. And here is the argument that runs through the second and the third discourse against the Arians. If the Son of God is a creature, he cannot unify us with the Father. Because he himself needs someone to unite him with the Father. But because he is of the nature of the Father, he unites us with the Father. And that union is deification, is divinization. So grace is the gift of deification. Of course, we, under the Islamic pressure, since the 7th century. To say deification in Arabic, ta'li aw uluha, you know, makes it a great crime in Islamic culture. Because there's only one God. But we are gods, according to the scriptures, according to the Psalms, according to the words of Christ himself. Because to be a God is a confession in the divinity of Jesus, not the other one, not the other way around. And that grace of deification or divinization is precisely where the divinity of the Son is working in us to bring us to full communion with the Father by the Holy Spirit. This is the work of the mediator. Number four, and this is my last point. Grace is also removing our origin from Adam to Christ. There is a lovely letter to Adelphos and Epictetus. These two letters are of prime importance for us. In both letters, we read the plan of salvation. Christ was born of a mother by the Spirit without human seed. Mary is the Theotokos. There is no father in that birth. In order that he may transfer our origin from corruption, from Adam to himself. And in the same letter, and in actually the third discourse against the Arians, paragraph 33, he says, the Word of God, the Logos, has assumed human body, and therefore he assumed in himself the whole of humanity. I stopped at this Greek word for almost half a day, because I don't like what has been said by some of our greatest scholars like Dr. Russell. Assumed the human race when he became human doesn't mean actually a solidarity, because that word solidarity has its social political connotation. No, he has taken a nature like our nature, and we are actually united because of the nature that is identical to our nature. We are united with Christ because he became human. The incarnation is Christ becoming human in order that all humans may be included in him. Included not in a matter of solidarity, as we have in the political, social, economic sense, but in a matter of being one with him in the same nature. This is very important. I debated the matter with Dr. Russell a long time ago, but the West is the West and the East is the East. Augustine would say later on, the Son of God became man, and he just says to each one of us, I am you, because I put on your humanity. This is the greatest love. So grace is not a favor. It's not something that reveals just God's pleasure. No. It's a participation in the divine life. And here, as we were removed from our first origin to the real eternal origin of Christ, in the first discourse against the Arians, paragraph 47, he says, when Christ came to Jordan to be baptized, it was we who were baptized in him. It was we who were washed. It was we who were sanctified. It was we who received the Spirit. You see, this is the head of the new creation. And the head of the new creation is not really just a mediator in the later evangelical sense, but he is the Logos creator. He's head of creation because he is the Logos. And he has received that position as being made man. A lovely story from our Alexandrian tradition. I like it because it says a great deal to me. About two sailors who were fishing in the port of Alexandria, and one of them made a boat, a fishing boat, and left it in the port, but at night there was a big gale, and the boat was taken to high seas. Another fisherman found the boat empty, lost, took it, escorted it to the port of Alexandria and claimed its ownership. The real owner saw his boat and started to fight with the man who actually rescued his boat. And so both of them decided to go to the bishop. And that bishop was assassinated. Nice story. And Athanasius said to the man, you made the boat, but your friend rescued your boat. So give him some money as a matter of honoring his labor. And by giving him some money for bringing back your boat to the port, you owned the boat twice. Once when you made it, and the second time when it was rescued by you. And he completes the story by saying, in this sense, Christ owned us twice. When he created us as Logos, and when he redeemed us as a Redeemer. We owe our being to him as our Creator, and for a second time, we owe our being to him as our Redeemer, because he redeemed us. And that brought peace with the between the two fishermen. Then he immediately, the bishop, said, in this sense, we can understand what Peter said on the day of Pentecost, that God made him, in Jesus, Lord and Christ. He was Lord and Christ as Creator, but has been made Lord and Christ as a Redeemer. Nice story. I like it because it shows the deep sense of wisdom, of pastoral insight, and at the same time settle dispute and make that settlement a nice short discourse about how Christ owned us twice. Well, my dear friends, my dear brothers and sisters in the Lord, let us enjoy the eternal grace. According to Paul, we were given that eternal grace without regret. God does not change his mind. And we receive grace in order that we may remain divine in spite of our weakness, in spite of our distracted minds, in spite of our inability to love God as he loves us. But in all our struggle, we must not forget. It's not me that became divine, it is the grace of God that made me divine. So the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, be glory, both now and forever. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Doctor. I have a question, if you're entertaining questions. It seems to me that from everything that you're saying, that I'm trying to word my question here, that it is more prudent to speak of two natures in Christ when discussing the matter of grace. Because for the one to give and the other to receive, it has to be so in Christ. But, of course, the Oriental mind might not be wired to receive such a thing. Of course, we can always go back and speak of, we're not talking about numerically one, we're talking about the unity and so on. But it seems that in order for this to be at least plausible rationally, there does need to be that emphasis of the two. Mm-hmm. What is your comment on that?
Well, we have to notice also the later Christological terminology, communicatio idumatum,
Yeah. The
communion of attributes.
Mm-hmm.
That without the two natures, there is no real communion between us and God.
Yeah.
Because through communion, comes to us when we receive Christ. And when we receive Christ, it's not a matter of mental meditation. It's a matter of actual reception of his life, especially in the sacraments. I am not aware that we really have a good patristic books or one book on the Eucharist. We don't. I have read the historical study of one of the Miskin. It's the only one that deserves reading. And there's another one by, I think, Miller Schnuller, which is not bad, but two things are missing from our discourse about grace, about Christology, about anything, which is included in the refrain of the Coptic Church that we normally say on Saturday, Fashir, at Vespers. He took what belongs to us and gave us what belongs to him. أَخَذَ الَّذِي لَنَا وَأَعْطَانَ الَّذِي لَهُ. You know, that he took what belongs to us is certainly humanity, and gave us what belongs to him. In the Theotokia, it says he gave us his body and blood, and gave us also his divinity. The two natures are certainly has to be treated in the context of salvation, of soteriology, rather than in the polemical accepting or rejecting chalcedon. That's a touch issue now. You mentioned chalcedon, all the demons will jump on you. You know? And there's no need to speak about chalcedon. But there is an urgent need to say there has been and is a communion of attributes in the incarnate Son of God. And as we say in the liturgy, that the body of Christ is life-giving body. He cannot be life-giving body if it is just a mere body, a nature. You know, nature is, in Cyril, actually means reality.
Mm-hmm.
Not nature in the abstract sense. It's you know, a reality of the incarnation that is truly human. And that the word human nature means the reality of us as human beings. So the change in the body of Christ, when he abolished in his own body death by the union and by accepting death in order to bring his body back to life. As Nestor says, very, very precise words by saying, all died in Christ. The sentence of this has been exhausted or completed in the body of Christ. And that is, in fact, all of us are crucified and died in him, which is an echo of Romans chapter 6. It's the very vocabulary of St. Paul is actually very, very polite. All died, why? Because, and here is the difference between Athanasius and Anselm. When God said, you are dust, and to dust you shall return, it was the Logos who said that. Not just the Father, but the Logos also. And because of his great love for humanity, he came to abolish that sentence of this. Out of his love. This has been repeated twice. You know. And in fact, the book on the Incarnation has to be read, in my opinion, has to be read at least 100 times. I read it more than once, 100 times maybe, 10 times maybe, 1,000 times maybe. But the most important thing is when I sat down to translate paragraphs into Arabic. Only then I noticed the very precise way of Saint Athanasius. You know, all were dead in Christ when he was crucified. The sentence of this actually being fulfilled, not abolished mentally, but in reality. But who can do this? The Logos. Because he is the creator. Who can abolish our sentence and replace it by life. That's again coming back to the communion or sharing the divine attributes. And here is the, in my opinion, very humbly I say that, not feeling very proud. Our church today is actually a monofilite church. Sadly. Only few laymen and few theologians escaped that great disaster.
Mm-hmm.
We are Eutychians, believe it or not. Because if you ask, not the church, represent clergy and the people, if you ask people, why do you think in this way? Why do you say, I receive the humanity of Jesus, not his divinity? You are a monophysite, if you say so.
Mm-hmm.
You split Christ. Actually, an historian also. Because, you see, I have to send to you something from the conference in Arabic about Neo-Arianism. It's a refutation of Ambab Shuri. There is a difficulty here in learning the deviation of all the schools of heresies. When they attack the divinity, we lose our salvation. When we deny his divinity, his humanity, we also lose our salvation. And since Manichaeism and Gnosticism and Arianism and Nestorianism and Eutychianism and even Apollinarius and Anomius and all the rest, it is how our salvation becomes an external relationship. External. You know, the great disaster that took place in 40 years under Ambab Shuri is that our redemption is external.
Mm.
It's something God can does between him and the Son. We are only witnessing. The same attitude of the evangelicals, which goes back to Arianism actually. The Son of God himself became a price paid to God the Father.
Yeah.
Well, that is Arianism. He is the Logos creator, cannot become a price. He is equal to the Father. So, it's Arianism, but with different vocabulary. Neo-Arianism, I would say.
Mm-hmm.
So, the two natures has to be brought together, not in the Chalcedonian fashion, talk about two natures, but about the change in the humanity of Jesus, which reaches us. Because once you speak of two natures, then all the
rabbit dogs start attacking. Yeah.
You know, it starts to wake up and say, he is a wicked infidel Chalcedonian. But you know, I haven't seen anything wrong with Chalcedon, as a matter of fact. The only thing that was wrong with Chalcedon is when they anathematized discourse and the teaching of Alexandria. That was improper. But the main bulk of the confession is still actually Orthodox. We sense Nestorianism in two natures in the person. But it should be two persons of one person. You know?
Persons.
Hmm?
You use the word persons. On purpose?
No, sorry. Two natures of one person. Sorry.
Because that was Severus's argument, that he wanted to use the word person.
Yeah.
Two persons.
No, this is
so
actually...
I find your use of it is interesting.
No, two persons would be blatantly Nestorianism, you know?
Yeah, right.
Question. How they explain the two in?
Two in is looked at, we're seen as Nestorian. But in fact,
not historian. How is it not
historian? Because in Christ, the proposition in in both English and en in Greek is quite common in Paul. It doesn't matter what you say, but it does matter what is the purpose of what you are saying.
But it can be explained as Nestorian.
It can be, yes, but it doesn't actually. When you say the one and the same is both divine and human, that's not Nestorian. The one and the same is straightforward statement.
But I feel that Leo, when he wrote that, he means it is historian believe.
Leo is not a theologian. Leo is a...
Yes.
No, he's not a theologian. He is a man who has no knowledge of church tradition, and his teaching is certainly very loose. It can be attacked easily by all those who refuse to look that there has been any shade of truth at Chalcedon. You know, I'm not saying that we should accept Chalcedon. They don't understand me. But we must not, as we refuse Chalcedon because of historical reasons, we must not suspect our Greek Orthodox brothers to be actual historians. Because they are not.
Actually, what I mean, the expression "in" is first used by Leo.
Before Leo was Fuad, it wasn't Chalcedon.
Thomas Leo before Chalcedon. Thomas Leo, أول ما طلع في مجمع أفسس, and it has this expression, and this expression is before Chalcedon.
Well, that's the West. You know, the West is normally very loose in creating a statement that has the very precise of the Greek. It's Latin. The Latin mind is always loose and always leans towards a textual verification rather than the content. And that has been our problem from the 4th century onwards. And still up till now, when we talk to our Catholic brothers and sisters, you can hear the loose Latin way of treating a subject like transubstantiation. You know? I don't know. I'm glad I'm out of the ecumenical dialogue. Really glad and very enjoy my life because 6 visits to Rome has convinced me that we are facing a dead end. You know, I never forget. For your own information, just in case there's no time to say that, maybe I die tomorrow. At the last stage when Paul the VI was ready to give up double procession of the Holy Spirit, Immaculate Conception of the Virgin Mary, you know, and the Purgatory. Quite ready to give up these three doctrines and to regard them as doctrines of the Western Church, and in the case of the Union, the Eastern Church need not to subscribe to them. Okay? But then came the crunch. That evening, I had dinner at the Rembrandt Institute with a great man whom I cherish his memory forever. Professor De Vries, the head of the chair of church history, and he is the expert on the Oriental churches. And he said to me, very clearly, in very clear English, Rome is quite keen to give up everything but not the papacy. They will let go of all doctrines but not the papacy. And once you are under the papacy, all the doctrines that have been denied will come back to you from the back door. And he said he was consulted by Paul the VI himself. And he said, yes, he will give up the double procession of the Holy Spirit. He will give up purgatory. He will give up Immaculate Conception. You'll give up anything that you think to be unacceptable. But when there is an ecumenical synod, he is the head of the synod. And with him alone, separately, all decisions must be taken. And you and your patriarchs and all the people present in that gathering are no more than consultants. So I said to him, you know, so what about going back to the ancient formula, primus inter pares, first among equals. I said, oh yes, he will sign for that. He said, but first among equals in the synod, international synod of the entire church, he's still the first. He's among equals, but when it comes to executive decision, it will be the Pope alone. Because that is deeply rooted in our canon, our canons, and you cannot change them. So he said, never ever accept any reference to the papacy. So here's a full story up to the year 2015, by the way. And he said, if you say that he is the patriarch of the West, that's actually freeze. That will be good, while you maintain the autocephaly of your churches in the East. Then at least in your own local synods, you are free from any doctrinal decision. So we are actually, Paul the VI accepted that. And I was absolutely surprised. But when Tadros II went to Rome, they dropped the title Pope. Because we agreed that there are two popes, of Alexandria and Rome. But now they speak of one Pope and Patriarch of Alexandria. He's not the Pope of Alexandria. They dropped the title completely. We insisted to say that there is a Pope of Alexandria and the Pope of Rome. And that comes in all the official documents that were signed in 1973. Signed next, signature of Pope Shenouda is next to the signature of Pope Paul VI. Now that has been abolished completely. Now we see what the papacy can do. That after Paul VI died, all the agreements that were reached in 1973 were completely abolished. When we returned under John Paul II, it was entirely new administration, new staff, new mentality, new everything, and we had to start from zero. By that time, our relationship with Amba Shenouda became very hard and very difficult. I left, Amba Gregorius left, Bishop Samuel was dead, Amba Ioannis was marginalized, and was no real dialogue between us and the Catholic Church. And now things back to what it was maybe 1,000 years ago, that you Copts have no Pope, you are just the Orthodox Church is the Oriental Rite, as you call us now. The Oriental Rite, not the Oriental Church, Oriental Rite. You are part of the Catholic Church, but you are the Oriental Rite, and you have to subject to the papacy. Now, what's happening now between our Theodorus II and the and Rome, I have no clue. I'm out. I'm glad I'm out. Because, you know, all the struggle from 1973 up till 1988 was about how we can create one unified church with a international synod that is the highest authority of the church. Paul VI accepted, John Paul II denied it, and that we ended with nothing. I have told you the story because maybe you will be the next generation that have to stand up and say, we know what was going on. nobody of Fuad wrote anything about the visit to Rome, right? You and Ramsey are historians.
No, about not. What? I did not hear what you said.
Nobody made an historical evaluation to our visit to Rome. From Paul VI to John Paul II.
Yeah.
Has not been evaluated yet, has it?
No, I
don't know. I left and I'm glad I left. Because, you know, the intrigue of the Catholic Church is beyond your imagination. You know, I remember once in Rome. I remember once in Rome in 1975. I sat next to John Romanidis.
Yeah. John Romanidis? What you said about John Romanidis?
We were Orthodox delegation at Rome in 1975.
John Romanidis, I believe, is the best theologian.
Oh, he's a great man.
The best.
And, you know, they gave us a rosé wine. Excellent. The bottle was 200 years old.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Oh, my goodness. You know, the food at the Vatican is beyond your imagination. and then he drank and felt merry.
He what?
He drank wine and felt merry and said to me in Greek and in English, George, don't drink that wine because after you drink it, they make us signs and documents.
Say that no. Again. I didn't hear the last part.
After you drink that wine, they will make us sign some documents.
Sign. Okay.
So if they bring anything, don't sign. I said to him, I can't sign. I don't treat them right, after all. And actually, I actually drank 3 glasses of wine that night. It's a wine that you can get anywhere in the world, you know. That bottle must be about $3,000-$4,000, if not more. And I said, Father John, drink it and enjoy it. I'll protect you. And you know, it was Jean Paul II came to the dinner, actually, but didn't eat with us. He came at the end to give us rosaries and blessings. And then on the way out, John said to me, I'm surprised it ended like that, so peacefully. I was expecting that they will ask us to sign something. I said, no. It was only an honorary dinner for miserable, poor Orthodox people who will never have money to buy this kind of wine. When I went to Athens a year later, and I sat again next to Romanides, they gave us very bad wine. And I said to him, you know, whispering, do you remember the wine that we drank in Rome? And he said, yes. Would you compare that with one of them? I said, no. This wine that our patriarch brought is the cheap wine the sailors drink when they are operating their boats. And then the Archbishop noticed that we are whispering, and he said, what are you whispering about? So I said to him in English, we are admiring the building. And Father Romain said, no, George, say the truth. George won't, he mentioned a wine I never heard of. And he said, ah, why didn't you say so? And then the good wine appeared. And it was really very good, but not really that, not as good as the wine in Rome. But, you know, this is ecumenical dialogue with all its downs and fears and distrust and so forth. May God save us. Okay. Any more comments, jokes?
You tell us a joke.
Dr. Ramsey.
In the ecumenical dialogue between the Eastern and the Oriental, I think they used some explanation. I can't remember the words exactly. But the Eastern said, if we talk about two natures, we distinguish them only in our thought,
yes,
our mind.
That's right.
But not in the reality.
Yes, that's right.
And so actually, that explains we can use them, but it's just the way you can talk about it.
Yes, but you know, Ramzi, this is the dialogue of the educated. If you say that in a church today, in the Coptic church, even you, being a highly dignified man, some finger will point at you and say, wicked Chalcedonian.
But that was accepted by Bishop Bishoy.
Yes.
He signed for it.
That was accepted by the bishop, that is true. But only at the level of the educated, not at the level of the mobs. You know, the mobs are driven by their feelings. You are right. It's actually being repeated 6 times since the meeting in Denmark in Aarhus.
Okay.
And in Bristol and in Chambézy. Yes. There are a lot of good things, but you know, here is the issue, that for the two churches to be united, it means there'll be no Greek patriarch in Alexandria. He has to go back to Greece. And the Greeks will not give up.
Okay.
So
one more comment.
Yes, sir.
Or question. We were talking about grace. And I think if we want to say what is grace, in one word, it's the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Is that right?
Perfect.
Okay.
What about Christ?
Because that's the gift of God to us.
Perfect.
As written in St. Luke, فَكَمْ بِالْحَرِي يُعْطِيكُمْ أَبُوكُمْ السَّمَاوِي الرُّوحَ الْقُدُسِ الَّذِينَ يَسْأَلُونَهُ. For that's the gift.
Perfect.
And it includes all of the other meanings. Okay, thank you.
Certainly, yes.
Abuna Matta has in one of his lectures, or sorry, his homilies, a comment where he said that he believed that for the longest time, but he was wrong because he believes very strongly that grace is Christ. And he uses the famous blessing with of the love of God the Father, the grace of his only begotten Son, and the communion and fellowship of his Holy Spirit to justify himself.
Okay, this is explained by what the Father say. Wherever the Holy Spirit is, the Son is.
Yes.
Wherever he is, the Son is.
I think
we can't have the Holy Spirit without the Son. And we can't have the Son without the Holy Spirit.
Yeah, if we use the Cyrillian formula from the Father through the Son in the Holy Spirit, that's perfectly acceptable. Yes.
Everything is in the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
That's what Athanasius said.
Yeah.
Yes, in the letter to Cyril. We need one day when we have the wine from Rome. if you give us the kind of wine, we'll come to Toronto, but that will cost you $10,000.
Culture wine, how about that?
What that?
I'll get you kosher wine. How about that?
Kosher wine? What is that? Never heard of it.
Kosher wine, the wine that that people use for the seders.
Oh no, that is that's only what Muhammad used to drink when he wrote the Quran.
There you go. We'll have a special bottle for you, Dr. George.
No, I'm only joking.
That'll be up to par, though.
No. What I'm trying to say is, it's not for fun, but you know, we have to laugh because our sadness is great, and the only way to release our sadness is to joke. No, but we really need, at a certain time when we talk about how do we renew our mind and have a Trinitarian way of thinking. Because there is a Trinitarian way of thinking. You know, we are monotheists because the great pressure of Islam in us has exerted its toll on all of us. The Trinitarian mind is what the Fathers actually, especially Cyril. I was very happy and overjoyed when the Dialogue on the Trinity by Cyril is translated now into Arabic by Dr. Joseph Feltes. And the Thesaurus also. But that book has to be read, you know, line by line, slowly, to yield its inheritance. Do you want me to send you a bibliography in English?
Yes, please. So we can try to see what we can get from from the booksellers.
Yeah, I'll do it tonight.
Thank you.
Is Norman Russell still in print?
He is, yes. I don't know about the thick book. I don't know about the one that was published from Oxford, but the St. Vladimir's one is
the one from Oxford should be over $100. It's a very expensive book.
Yes, but there's the paperback. It's much cheaper. It's around $60-something.
Yeah. But don't buy a copy by Julius Gross. I've got a copy for you. It's a bribery.
As long as you write a little word in there for me.
All right, and that will bring you to sit next to me on the same bench.
I'll be more than happy to sit beside you on that same bench.
Can you imagine that his dissertation was published in 1938?
That's amazing.
June 38.
Yeah.
I was born in November 38.
Yeah.
Can you imagine that in 1938 that dissertation was at Strasbourg? Why will he fast asleep eating furu tamiya in Egypt? Anyway, I have to go. نعم سيدي.
طلب خارج الموضوع.
نعم سيدي.
عايز مقال ولو صغير عشان أقفل المجلة.
أبعت لك أشوف أنا أصلي كان إيميل بتاعي عطلان يا أخي فؤاد. واحد من القديسين طبعا عمل هاكينج. واخد بالك؟ لا ده حقيقة. فجبت مهندس الكترونيك انجينير من الجامعة قعد الراجل اشتغل نص يوم حاطين معرفش دخلت ازاي برنامج بيخليهم يخشوا على الايميل وعلى الفايلز بتاعتي من غير ما اعرف.
انا الكمبيوتر بتاعي حرميه.
هو بيقول لي عشان انت ليك يعني because you have a political file. حد عملها. قلت له شوف political file, religious file, I am innocent. I will send you several ones and make your choice and don't put my name on it. Otherwise you come sit next to me on the same bench.
انا عايز مقالة صغيرة
في حدود قد ايه؟
عن الكتاب المقدس. اي حد
في حدود قد ايه؟
صغيرة اوي يعني يعني ثلاث صفحات.
اوكي حاضر.
ثلاث صفحات من المجلة بتاعتي
هبعتها لك النهارده وانت حر فيها. شوف يا ايها المؤرخ الكسلان علينا البخيل علينا, لما ابعت لك حاجه انت حط تصرف فيها, تختصر قطعها ترميها انت حر.
شكرا.
ولما تبقى بتاعتك حط اسمك عليها. مش عايز تحط اسمك عليها.
لا مش هحط.
حط اسم رامز عليه.
حاضر.
حط اسم الدكتوره سلوى عليه.
خلاص.
عشان تيجي تحصلني تقعد على الدكة جنبي هي كمان.
خلاص.
يعني هتكون لحد دلوقتي ما حرموش ولا واحدة ست في الكنيسة. يخافوا من الستات على فكرة.
Everything there is a first.
بيخافوا من الستات. فخلي الحرمان يوصل للدكتورة سهلو وبعدين تقوم بقى ثورة نسائية طبعا. تطيح بالأنبا بشو والأنبا تودروس تبقى حكاية بقى. طيب. سلام ومحبة يا إخوة. ابعتك مقالة دلوقتي حالا.
شكرا.
عفوا يا حبيبي تحت امرك.
الف شكر.
سلام يا رامز.
سلام.